So good morning, Pleasant. Good morning, Babu Narayan, sir. Yeah, good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. Is my voice audible to you?
Good morning.
Yeah.
Very good morning to you all.
Yeah, good morning, sir. So shall we start the session?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. So good morning to you all. So welcome you all for the second session of today's FDTP program. So on behalf of Department of Civil Engineering, Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering, I'm very much happy to welcome Dr. K.S. Babu Narayan, Professor, Department of Civil Engineering of NIT K. Suratkal, to address the participants on the topic strain energy method. So I welcome you, sir, on behalf of all the participants present here. And I'm very happy to introduce Dr. K.S. Babu Narayan to the participants. So as I mentioned previously, he is presently Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, NIT Karnataka, Suratkal. So his area of research interest are structural analysis and design, which includes RCC, pre-stressed concrete and steel, structural optimization, the mathematical modeling, and also unsaturated soil mechanics. He has completed about the guidance, that is, he has supervised about 8 PhD scholars so far, and currently he is guiding about 5 PhD scholars. So he has several accomplishments, awards and recognitions to his credit. He is a GJEC visiting professor in Kumamoto University, Japan, and also he is the design of Infant Jesus Shrine K2 Chandraloka, Inland Windsor, and Arista Enclave that have won the UltraTech Outstanding Concrete Structure Award. He is a member of the team that conceived, analyzed, designed, detailed, and installed the centrally remote controlled quick release mooring system at New Mangalore Port Trust, which has been approved and appreciated by the Indian Register of Shipping. He is also a technical consultant and advisor to the ACC Help Center and Birla Super. Dr. K.S. Babu Narayan. So he is also the technical committee head and coordinator of Dakshina Kannada Nirmiti Kendra. The Kendra has won excellence award instituted by HUDCO for promotion of cost effective housing technology. He has also received B.R. Samagra Civil Engineer Award in the year 2007 by the Institution of Engineers. And also he has been honored with Eminent Engineer Award by the Association of Consulting Civil Engineers in the Engineers Day celebrated during the year 2011. And also he has received the Outstanding Constructor Award in the year 2016 from ACC Cement. And also he has received Lifetime Achievement Award in the year 2018 during the ACCE Foundation Day celebrations. Also, he is the recipient of Lifetime Achievement Award in the year 2020 from UltraTech ACCE. And he is the president of Mangalore chapter of Indian Association for Structural Rehabilitation. He is the honorary secretary of Institution of Engineers Mangalore Local Center. He is the member of ICI. And also he has got membership in different professional bodies like Indian Society, Association of Structural Engineers, Asian Center for Engineering Computations and Software. And also he is the lead author of Deconstruction Manual. He has visited many foreign countries to deliver various special lectures. To mention a few, so he has delivered lecture at the School of Ocean Civil Engineering, Kagoshima University of Japan in 2006, 2009, 10, 11, and 2012 also. He has chaired various technical sessions at the 10th East Asia Pacific Conference on Structural Engineering and Construction in Bangkok in August 2006. And also he has visited Dundee University, UK. He also visited College of Science and Technology, Royal University of Bhutan, University of California, and Kagoshima University, Kumamoto University, Osaka University, and Osaka Prefecture Universities at Japan as a part of research interaction. And he is an accomplished player of electric guitar and disciple of San Maestro Kathri Gopalnath. So I think we have a very eminent speaker today with us, Dr. K.S. Babu Narayan, to share his expertise on the topic strain energy method. So on behalf of all the participants present here, I'm very much pleased to welcome you, sir, for this particular session. Yeah, so thank you once again for accepting our invitation. So now the session is over to Dr. K.S. Babu Narayan.
Thank you very much. Yes. Shall we?
Yes.
Well, share the presentation. Just tell me if it is visible.
Yeah. Yeah, the screen is visible, sir. You can just try for the slideshow mode.
Is it visible now?
Yeah, it is visible.
Okay. Thank you very much for the introduction. For that, very happy to be all of you, where I will be presenting in the world. Before we start with the action of loads and the method itself, we all know we build structure with an intended end use and for a specified utility period. What do we mean by intended end use? It may be a building, we're something a shelter, it may be a bridge, it may be a chimney, it may be a tunnel, and so on and so forth. Whatever we build, it may be a stadium, it may be a museum. There is a specified intended end use. And also we build a structure for a specified utility period, what do we call as the design period. And the satisfaction of the intended purpose of the end use by the structure is what we call as a functional requirement. A bridge should provide means of communication over obstructions. A water tank should hold water. A dam should check water. And the tunnel should provide passage through obstruction. That is the intended end use. That is a functional requirement. It has to be satisfied. We cannot afford to have a structure where the function itself is not being performed. But very fortunately for us, we have architects who take care of the functional requirements. And once the functional requirements are taken care, structural engineers take over to satisfy what do we call as the long list of structural requirements. The satisfaction of structural requirement includes or involves, we should ensure first is the structure should be stable. Under any conceivable system of loading, equilibrium should be maintained. Whatever we build should be stable. Stability is one important requirement of any structure. Followed by strength. Strength is capacity to carry loads. The elements of the structure and the structure as a whole should be strong enough to sustain the load application. A structure should be stable, a structure should be strong. Followed by structure should be safe. The problem is we do not know the exact values of the load. And neither we can get the exact values of the strength. We don't know either of them accurately. So there is always...
excuse me, Professor Babu Narayan, sir. Excuse me, sir. Excuse me, sir. Can you please share the slide in the slideshow mode, sir? Because you are in the first slide, right?
I'm in the first slide, yes. I have not...
Okay. Just put the slideshow, sir. You just put a slideshow so that it will be a full screen mode.
Right.
No, it is not coming in full screen.
Not audible.
It is not coming in full screen, sir. Sir, you share your screen instead of window. You share your screen. And then you open the PPT, sir.
What is visible?
Yeah, now it's fine, sir. Now it is fine.
Okay. I'm talking something different from what is there in the slide. I'll come to this slide later. Okay, structure should be stable, structure should be strong. I said and a structure should be safe. But we don't know either the loads exactly or the strength exactly. And philosophy is strength should always be more than the load. And the margin is what do we call as safety. There are a lot many ways in which we assess, a lot many levels also to assess safety, including the reliability technique. A structure should be stable, a structure should be strong, a structure should be safe, followed by a structure should be serviceable. Deflection is the end product of the loading forces. Nothing is infinitely rigid. The final product of the loading process is the deformation, the displacement. How much of this is acceptable to us? Right? We should know, and that is what we call a serviceability requirement. And in case of concrete structures, we have another interesting or annoying or rather very difficult requirement like limiting the crack width. Deflection and cracking is to be considered. The serviceability requirements cannot be violated. There are limitations on fire resistance. There are limitations on vibrations and so on and so forth. They all fall in the category of serviceability. We should ensure serviceability. A structure should be stable, a structure should be strong, a structure should be safe, a structure should be serviceable, and a structure should be durable also. And this is another important aspect. And whenever you ask somebody what durability is all about, everybody will say durability is long lasting. Immediately the next question comes as to how long is long enough? What is the length you are talking about? Alright, so we specify what do we call as the design period. All the functional and the structural requirements should be satisfied over the entire utility period, which is called as the design period, which is what we call as durability. All this is a real tall order. And all this should be done at an affordable cost. Structure should be economical also. The cost cannot be astronomical. If funds are not a problem, if time is not a constraint, if resources are not a constraint, nobody has any problem. We are constrained by time, money and efforts. So whatever we do should be economical too. Economy is again a misconceived concept. Many people think saving is economy. People talk in terms of cutting costs. You don't get anything of quality for low cost, for cheap. Cheap and low cost essentially means quality also is low. So we should talk of cost effectiveness. Then we should try to get the maximum from the available resources. That is what we mean by economy. Economy is not saving. Economy is wise spending. So the onus of doing all this is with the structural engineer. And the structural engineer has to analyze and design structure satisfying all these requirements. And strain energy method is one of the methods of great use or utility or importance in analysis and design of structure. Alright, so now we start our discussion on strain energy method itself. Well, yeah, in the first slide, I have put under the action of applied loads, the structure as a whole and also the elements they deform. The loaded configuration of the structure is slightly different from the unloaded. It has to be. As I told you, nothing is infinitely rigid. And deformation or deflection is the end product of the loading process. So if you load an element or a structure, it deforms. Now, for determinate structures, we'll see what determinate and indeterminate structures are all about a little later. For determinate structure, as the extremely small changes have no significant effect on the geometry. Usually, the load application, even though there are deformation and there are deflection, these are going to be very small. These should be small enough. For determinate structures, but the extremely small changes have no significant effect on the geometry. The unloaded configuration is taken as the basis for determination of internal force. Unload, we take the unloaded configuration as the deformed configuration too, because the changes are going to be minimal. What do we call as the small deformation theory, and we should be very careful in application of the theory. We call it as the first order analysis, where we assume deformations are small. How small is small enough is a question to be answered. But we assume this. In case of determinate structures, as extremely small changes have no significant effect, the unloaded configuration is taken for the basis of determination of internal force. However, if the structure is indeterminate or hyperstatic, which is another good name for indeterminate structure, structures that cannot be solved by statics alone are called hyperstatic structures. However, in indeterminate or hyperstatic structure, you should take account of the deformation. Account needs to be taken of the deformations in calculation of response quantity. So knowledge of assessment of deformation becomes very, very important. We cannot do away with deformation when it comes to indeterminate structure. Again, we have to consider equilibrium, we have to consider compatibility, and also we should honor force deformation relationship. We need all the three to understand, to analyze, to solve, and design an indeterminate structure. If it is a determinate structure where all the responses can be got from static alone, we may not have to worry. And then again, what is very important is the deformations have to be small. There again, even in a determinate structure, the deformation has to be small to ignore the changes in geometry. That's why we talk about material non-linearity and geometric non-linearity. Having said that, if analysis can solely be based on equilibrium conditions, that is without consideration of deformation, then we say the structure is determinate. We can solve for the response quantities without considering deformations in the first place. If not, if it cannot be done, then we call the structure is indeterminate or hyperstatic. We cannot get the response from equilibrium equations alone. As I already told you, you should consider equilibrium, you should consider compatibility, and also the force deformation relationship. That is the word in high sounding words is called as a statically admissible force field, a kinematically admissible displacement field, and the constitutive relationship. All the three should be honored. Only then you will be in a position to get the response. So here is an example. You consider a frame, a single story, single bay frame with a beam carrying a load at its center, and at the base the columns are hinged at A and D. You have a frame ABCD, beam carrying a central concentrated load. The end A and D are hinges. Now, if you come to the left side, if the columns are very stiff, your bending stiffness is tremendous. Columns are very stiff. The beam behaves almost as a fixed beam. Right? The beam almost behaves as a fixed beam. And you can see the bending moment diagram beneath that. You can see virtually almost no bending in the column. The columns are very stiff. There, as you can see, the elastic curve of the bend profile of the beam. The beam will behave almost as a fixed beam. That is only when the column is very stiff. But at the other extreme, if the columns are very flexible, the beam almost behaves like a simply supported beam. Although you have the column, since the columns are very flimsy and they offer no much resistance to bending, the beam will behave almost like ethically supported beam. You can compare the bending moment diagram of these two cases. In one case, the positive moment for the beam is less, negative moment is high because of the fixity provided by the column. Whereas in the other case, where the beam is behaving almost like a ethically supported beam, the sagging moment or the positive bending moment is much larger than the negative bending moment. Negative bending moment is very small. This is decided by the relative stiffness of the beam and the column. Relative stiffness influences the force distribution in a structure. Relative stiffness, you understood. The column is too stiff, the beam behaves as fixed. If the column is too flimsy, it almost behaves like simply supported. In between, it is partial basic. Neither behavior is very close to simply supported, nor it is very close to fixed, it is partially fixed. The partial fixity is because of the relative stiffness of members at the joint. So it is very important the deformation characteristics decide the force distribution. This one characteristics of indeterminate structures you should always be aware of. In case of determinate structure, we don't care about what the stiffness is. It is only a simply supported beam. If it is a cantilever beam, we can get the force response. But for the calculation or the assessment of the dead load, which is going generally to be a minuscule fraction of other load, you need to know the size only for assessment of the dead load. Otherwise, you will simply say, a simply supported beam loaded with uniformly distributed load throughout, the maximum moment is WL squared by 8, or for a cantilever, it is WL squared by 2, and so on and so forth. But not so in case of frame, where the responses are decided by the relative stiffness. This is very important for you to recognize. Now we'll have another instance. Let us say the frame is 3 inch. We have a hinge at the center of the beam where we are applying the load. If you have this as the case, now the structure is determinate. So earlier frame was hinged at the base. The single story single frame, how we determine the degree of indeterminacy is 3 into number of closed circuits. There is one closed circuit. So 3 into 1 is the number of closed circuits is 3. The value is 3. 3 into number of closed circuits. Since the closed circuit is only 1, you get the number 3. And the number of releases, you have two releases, moment releases at A and D. So minus 2, 3 minus 2 is 1. The degree of indeterminacy of this frame is 1. Whereas when you introduce a central hinge in the beam, what you are seeing here, 3 into number of closed circuits is 3 minus number of releases. You have a release at 8, there is a moment release, you have a release at D, there is a moment release, and you have a release at the central hinge. A 3 releases, so 3 minus 3 is 0. This structure is determinate. Without considering the deformation characteristics of what are going to be the relative stiffness of the beam and the column, you can simply get the force response. So that is what has been done in the sketch shown. You have the load as W, the vertical reactions at the base should be W by 2 each because of the symmetry. And once you know the vertical load at the base, you take the moment of this load above the central hinge. So W by 2 into L by 2 will be the moment. So W by 2 into L by 2 is WL by 4, and the moment has to be 0. So you should have a horizontal force of the magnitude of WL by 4H. Now you can draw the entire bending moment diagram without considering the deformation characteristics. This is what we call as a determinate structure. So you have introduced the H and you have removed 1 degree of indeterminacy. And that brings us to the question, why we should have hyperstatic structure or indeterminate structures at all. Majority of the structures are hyperstatic because they are built so. They simply supported, fixed, and so on and so forth. These are all what we call as our idealization. There is nothing perfectly fixed, and there is nothing perfectly simply supported. When you say an end is simply supported in a beam, it should allow rotation. Complete rotation should be allowed. But when you say fixed, it should be truly fixed. No rotation should be allowed at all. Such things cannot ever be guaranteed. Strictly speaking, we don't have a truly fixed support. We don't have a truly simply supported support again. Where the rotations are completely arrested or where rotations are fully permitted. Majority of the structures fall into the class of hyperstatic or indeterminate because they are built so. Well, how we build the structure? Indeterminacy arises from multiple reasons. Why we have indeterminate structures is because of many reasons. We may have extra elements, we may have support fixities, or it may be due to the geometry of the structure. Like, for example, shells, folded plates, 3D structures are inherently indeterminate. Even with assembled elements, continuity is preferred in the final structure. You get to see a lot of pre-engineered buildings and also prefabricated construction. We fabricate the elements and then we do the assembly. Even in such structures, we prefer continuity. That's why structures become hyperstatic or indeterminate. Even with assembled elements, continuity is preferred in the final structure. So it becomes hyperstatic or indeterminate. Most of the three-dimensional structural forms are inherently indeterminate. So giving the, in fact, strictly speaking, a slab is a three-dimensional structure. It is highly indeterminate system, but we idealize it to beams of unity. It is all our idealization. We ignore the torsional strength and we consider it to be an assemblage of beams of unit. We follow the same analysis and design for subsequent parts or part of that nature. Forces in indeterminate structures are generally smaller. So you know this. If you have a simply supported beam loaded with uniformly distributed load, the maximum moment at the center is going to be WL squared by 8. But instead, if the beam is fixed, the maximum moment is at the ends, and that is WL squared by 12. And now the maximum moment at the center becomes WL squared by 24. In case of simply supported, you had the moment as WL squared by 8. And the maximum moment for a fixed beam with load, with uniformly distributed load, the maximum value is the support, and it is only WL squared by 12. There is a drastic reduction in the force response. They are smaller. Forces are generally smaller. And so also the displacement. If bending moment itself is smaller, definitely bending stress also should be smaller. Because we know M by I into Y is the stress, or M by Z. The moment divided by the section modulus should give you the bending stress. When bending moment drops, bending stresses also become smaller. And also the displacement. The displacement will definitely be smaller in an indeterminate structure. You all know, for a simply supported beam, the maximum deflection is given by I by 384 WL to the power of 4 by EI. Delta, due to uniformly distributed load, in a simply supported beam, the maximum value is at the center. And the value is I by 384 WL to the power of 4 by EI is the formula. And what is interesting is this delta can never be zero. Even if there is no load on the beam, it will have its self weight. So there is some value for W. If there is a beam, there is a span, there is a value for L. However high the inertia is, or however strong the material is in terms of Bench modulus E, delta will never be zero. That is why I said deflection is the end product of the loading process. So for a simply supported beam, you understood it is 5/384 WL^4/EI. But for a fixed beam, it is going to be 1/384 WL^4/EI. It is just 1/5. That's why hyperstatic structures are preferred. They are stiffer. Next, redundancy also offers additional safety. You know, a cantilever beam can perform definitely properly designed, properly detailed, not overloaded, so on and so forth. All these are requirements. But then you design a good cantilever. The beam should perform as a cantilever as long as the end is fixed, the stretch is adequate, it is safe, and it does not deflect too much more than permitted, and so on and so forth. It performs. But we have prop cantilever, where you provide a prop at the end of the cantilever beam. Even though cantilever can perform, why you need the prop at all? That is what we call as the redundant. Provide the prop, it offers additional safety. If at all there is some problem at the fixed end, it is not truly fixed, it is only partially fixed, and so on and so forth. So once you have this prop, if the fixity is lost at the fixed end, that means there is no bending resistance, moment resistance offered at the end at all, and it can perform as a simply supported beam. Can definitely do so, right? And if the moment of resistance offered at the end, fixed end, is not good enough to sustain the full load operating on the cantilever, as a cantilever, it can still perform with partial fixing, with enough ductility. That is what we say. A structure with enough ductility, even though if compatibility requirements are violated, but if equilibrium requirements are satisfied, can stay. So redundancy offers a lot of additional safety. That is what the next sentence is all about. Redundant structures with adequate ductility have the ability to redistribute forces from overstressed portions to understress, and they give ample warning before failure. A hyperstatic structure or an indeterminate structure with enough ductility will have the facility to redistribution of forces from overstressed locations to understressed, and also give you warning before failure. What do we mean by ductility? Is accommodation of tremendous deformation before rupture. Glass as a material is brittle. You drop glassware, it immediately shatters. But if you drop a steel tumbler, it will not shatter. At the most, it can have a dent. Steel as a material. Some materials accommodate tremendous deformation before failure. This capacity to accommodate tremendous deformation before failure is what we call as ductility, and that is what is desired of a structural material. So any structure made of ductile material or with ductile characteristics, and if it is hyperstatic, it will have reserve strength. It can accommodate overloads also by redistributing stresses or forces from overstressed locations to understressed, and it can provide you ample warning before complete failure, before becoming a mechanism. This becomes a very great issue, an important thing to be understood by designers and analysts, also detailers, and it should be taken advantage of. These are the reasons for why structures are hyperstatic or indeterminate. I have given one sketch. Check on whether a structure is determinate or indeterminate depends on how the structure or the element is supported. One, in the configuration, how many restraints are there, how many equations of equilibrium are available to us for solution, and what is the difference? Do we need to consider compatibility equations or displacements for their analysis and so on and so forth. So if you take articulated structure, that is another level. Another level in the sense, not only even in case of frame, we talk of external determinacy and internal or indeterminacy. The structure may be externally determinate, internally may not be so. The structure may be internally determinate, externally may not be so. And all this is very tall order. And also, what is very important is sometimes if you simply write the equation for determinacy and indeterminacy, you may come to a conclusion that everything is fine. Whether it is determinate or indeterminate, maybe the way in which the members have been organized may lead to instability. That also needs to be checked. All right. I have given a few examples. For example, you have at the first example, a beam. On one end you have a hinge, the other end you have a roller. Means the total number of unknown reactions are 3, and it is loaded with an inclined load. The number of equations available to us from statics, sigma h is equal to 0, sigma v is 0, sigma m is equal to 0. We have 3 equations, we have 3 unknowns. So the structure is determinate, or the degree of static indeterminacy is the difference. Unknown forces and the equation of equilibrium available to us, 0, is determinate. Whereas when you come to the example next, you have a fixed end and you have 2 rollers, one at the end and one in between. And it is loaded with the uniformly distributed load, there is no horizontal load. So sigma h is equal to 0 is of no consequence for us here. So we have 2 equations. And then we have 4 unknown forces, 1, 2, 3, and 4. One moment and 3 forces. All right? So the difference, unknown forces and the equations available to us makes it 2. So this structure is indeterminate, the degree 2. What also we can do is, if you remove the 2 roller supports, the structure can still perform as a cantilever. They are the redundant. Extra, more than necessary. So it becomes hyperstatic or indeterminate. The first wheel is determinate. You need not worry about the deformation response, as you can straight away use equilibrium equations to get the response of the structure to load. But it's not so in case B. Check case C. We have a hinge and 2 rollers. And there is an internal hinge too. The internal hinge offers us one more equation. Sigma h is equal to 0 is of no consequence, but we have sigma m is equal to 0, sigma b is equal to 0, and one more additional equation, moment of all forces, either to the right or to the left, should be 0 at the internal hinge. So that makes it determinate. So on and so forth. How the elements are organized, how the supports are organized, what the loading condition is, so on and so forth, decide whether the structure is determinate, indeterminate, whether it is hyperstatic, indeterminate. And this can be very complicated. Many times, only by inspection, we may not be in a position. There are not many suggestions in articulated structures to do what a first scan. You may have the required number of members and joints according to the equation, but the very way in which the members have been organized may not be all right. It may lead to internal instability and so on and so forth. Stability is another level. Configuration should be such that you have adequate supports, and you have arranged the elements of the structure in the correct way so as not to cause instability. listed more too. Like for example, we'll take the rectangular frame with unequal legs. If you take the rectangular frame with unequal legs, here you have four unknown forces and only three equations of equilibrium are available. So the degree of indeterminacy of the redundancy is one. Also, this can be worked out by the formula which I told you already. 3 into number of closed circuits. So number of closed circuits is 1. 3 into 1 is 3. And number of releases are only 2. You have 2 moment releases at the base. So 3 minus 2 makes it 1. Structure is determined into degree 1. So seeing how the supports are organized, the members are organized, or configured in the geometry, you can decide, or you can get the degree of indeterminacy. So many people are of the notion with the present day availability of the software, user friendly application oriented software, what is the sanctity or what is the need to know, what is the degree of indeterminacy or the degree of indeterminacy or the degree of freedom and so on and so forth. All this becomes very important when you even consider, we were talking about redistribution and the reserve strengths available in indeterminate structure. When you enter the annals of plastic theory or plastic analysis or limit analysis, and in case of RC structures, there is the requirement of satisfaction of what we call as the rotation requirement or the rotation capacity, then definitely you should know how many hinges are required for the mechanism, how many hinges are required at collapse. The rotation capacity required for the hinges should be satisfied at all hinges except the last. So you should know how many hinges are required first of all for the mechanism. And the number of plastic hinges required for correct collapse mechanism is one more than the degree of indeterminacy. Unless you know how to establish or how to determine the degree of indeterminacy, you will be at a loss to know how many hinges are required for the correct collapse mechanism. Like earlier, the sanctity of indeterminacy or the degree of indeterminacy, whether it is static or the kinematic, was to decide whether we are using a force method or the displacement method. In the force method of analysis, we always treat forces as unknown. Right, and the displacement method will treat displacement as unknown. So the degrees of freedom of the kinematic indeterminacy is decided by the degrees of freedom. How many degrees of freedom you have? Means how many displacement values are known to you? And the static indeterminacy is decided by how many unknown forces you have, and how many equations you have. Right? If the unknown, finally, if the degree of static indeterminacy and kinematic indeterminacy, when you compare the two, if static indeterminacy is more and kinematic indeterminacy is less, it makes sense to use displacement method. So the unknown displacements are less. If it is the other way around, you should use the force method. There it adds sanctity to decide whether we should go by the force method, the displacement method. So decide, let us say you have only one unknown displacement, but when there are two unknown forces, displacement approach is better. Once you solve the unknown single displacement, you know the structure. If it is the other way around, if you have only one unknown force and two unknown displacements, the approach should be different. Like for example, you have a simply supported beam. The simply supported beam is statically determined. Statically determined in the sense there are only, like for example, we have this in the sketch A, the determinate structure. The degree of statically indeterminacy is zero. Whereas the degree of kinematic indeterminacy is degrees of freedom. If you take the first support, that is a hinge support, it can rotate. There you have 1 degree of freedom. If you come to the roller support, the roller cannot move vertically. It offers resistance in the vertical direction. But horizontal movement is allowed. Rotation also is allowed. So the number of unknown displacements are three. You don't know the slope at injured, you know, don't know the slope at the dropped end, but also you don't know the horizontal displacement of the roller. The number of unknown displacements are three. Whereas it is statically determined. But if you take a simply supported beam, forget the horizontal load. If you take a simply supported beam, you have two unknown displacements, the slopes at either end. Whereas if you take a fixed beam, kinematically it is determined. Kinematically it is determined means you know the slopes and displacements are zero at the end, but not statically determined. All these subtle differences you should know. What do we mean by degrees of freedom? What do we mean by static indeterminacy? What do we mean by kinetic movement? What do you mean by external determinacy or indeterminacy, internal, and so on? You read very good texts in structural mechanics, you will get a lot of information. Otherwise, we will be spending a lot of time in discussing only determinacy and indeterminacy. We will go ahead. So now we will start discussing the strain energy method itself. You know, when a bar elongates or shortens under applied tension or compression, if you pull a bar, we call the force as tension. Under the tensile force, the bar elongates. If you are pushing the bar, compression, the bar shortens. When a bar elongates or shortens under tension or compression, tension extends, compression shortens. The work done by the load, you know, when a force moves through a distance, it does work. On application of the load, will be deformation. So because of this effect, the load does work. The work done by the load gets stored as strain energy. And when the load is removed, the stored energy does work to restore the original configuration. When the load does work, the work then gets stored as energy. When the release of the load is done, the original configuration gets restored because the restored energy does work in the opposite direction. Like for example, a spring. The spring is compressed by the effort of the load. Whatever is the effort is stored as energy in the spring. And when you release the load, the spring gets back to the original position because whatever energy was stored when the work was done on the spring is now available for restoration of the configuration. So the work done by the load gets stored as energy or internal work, that is called strain energy. And we have these basic states of stress. The basic states of stress are tension. Tension is a pull to hold a bar. Try to pull it apart. We call the load effect as tension. We are trying to separate the particles of the material. Compression, you are trying to push or you are trying to squash. Compression shortens, tension elongates. Flexure, that is bending. So if you hold a yardstick and flex it or bend it, you know from your table theory of bending, some fibers extend, some fibers shorten, and there will be one fiber which does not either extend or shorten, hence it is not strained, and that is called the neutral axis, and so on and so forth. This you know from your simple theory of bending. So the effect of flexure or bending is to cause tension in some fiber and to cause compression elsewhere. Right? So the effect of flexure again is tension and compression. Shear, shear distance. If you have a small element subjected to shear, and if you observe the two diagonals of the element, one of the diagonal extend, another diagonal shorten. So the effect of shear is to cause diagonal tension and compression. So these are all basic stress states. And finally, the torsion. Twisting or torsion can be viewed as three-dimensional counterpart of shear. If you hold a box and if you twist, you can see one of the solid diagonals extending, another solid diagonal shortening. So there will be tension and compression in space. And we all know, after washing the clothes, we do the wringing of the clothes or wrenching of the clothes. We hold and we twist it to squeeze the water out. By twisting effort, one of the diagonals that is in compression will squeeze. Another way of squeezing the water out is by applying compression. So this becomes easier. So these are all the basic states of stress. You have tension, you have compression, you have flexure, you have shear, and you have torsion. And not only, generally what do we do is, when we study all of them, we study simple tension, simple compression, simple bending, pure shear, pure torsion. And in real life situation, nothing is pure. We have a combination of them. Axial load with bending, axial load with twisting, bending and shear, bending, shear and torsion. We'll have to even consider the interaction. But then these are the basic states of stress. And we should be in a position to assess or compute what we call as the strain energy due to these basic stress effects. But that is what we are going to see next. So we have expressions for strain energy, axial, flexure, shear, and torsion stress state. So, you know, if you take, that is the, we have two vertical columns, one in terms of the force, other column is in terms of displacement. We can express strain energy either in terms of forces or in terms of displacement. So now we consider axial force. You know, axial force, the force is P. The displacement is PL by A. And average force or average displacement will be half of that. Either you can take the force as half or the displacement as half. If you multiply the two, you will get the expression for strain energy due to axial force. That becomes P into PL by AE by 2, that is P squared L by 2 AE. So if you want to express this in terms of displacement, the AE term goes to the numerator. So the delta is PL by AE. You can substitute for P in terms of delta, and you get the expression. The expression can be either in terms of load or in terms of displacement. Why it is so, or why it should be done so, or what are the advantages of doing it so, we'll see the afternoon session. This is the expression. In terms of force, in terms of displacement, for strain energy due to axial. And next we have the expression for flexure. In terms of, first you have, first column gives you in terms of the moment. You know, M is the moment. M by EI. M by EI is called the curvature. M by EI is called the curvature. If you multiply curvature with the length, you get the rotation. The work done by moment is always in terms of moment into theta. The average is divided by 2. So M is the moment. M by EA is the curvature. M by EA is the curvature into length is theta. So M into theta by 2. The first column gives you the strain energy due to bending in terms of moment, the same in terms of rotation. Can also be written in terms of the displacement. For moment, the displacement is rotation, right? It becomes EI theta squared by 2L. We should always be in a position to recognize whenever it is in terms of loads, these terms, rigidity terms like AE, EI and all, they will be in the denominator. If it is in terms of forces, if it is in terms of displacement, these terms will be in the numerator. We should be in a position to express strain energy in terms of both displacement and in terms of loads. And next we have the expression for shear. The expression for shear is not as simple as it has been stated here. You should also know this A, whatever is written here, should be effective area. And it depends on the cross section itself. For circular section it is different, for rectangle it is different, and for high section it is different. You will consult literature for the right value of A. This is a simple expression in terms of shear force. The strain energy is given by V squared L by 2AG. And in terms of deformation, it is AG I squared by 2L. Where G is the shear modulus, like you have the Young's modulus. And for twisting, for torsion, it is T squared L by 2GJ, where J is the polar moment of energy, or it is the torsional constant. GJ psi squared by 2L in terms of the twist angle. Right? One should be in a position to write expressions for strain energy for axial, flexure, shear, torsion, states of stressors, so that they can be employed in calculations properly and utilized in analysis and design. And here again, what is very important is if you see the expressions for the strain energy, whether it is for axial load, whether it is for bending, for shear or torsion, you have V squared, M squared, V squared. Strictly speaking, superposition does not work for strain energy. If you have two axial forces, you cannot take the total strain energy as one for P1 squared and the other for P2 squared. Simply add them. Because P1 plus P2 the whole squared will be P1 squared plus P2 squared plus 2P1 P2. It cannot simply be done that way. Strain energy cannot be superimposed. And the question immediately arises with that in calculation, can we club all these effects? But when it comes to the effect of loading on elements, generally we are at an advantage. Like for example, if you take a simply supported beam, the simply supported beam will have maximum moment at one location, and at that location shear is minimum. The shear is maximum elsewhere. Many times mere addition also works if you clearly look into what is the situation, what is being addressed. These are the fundamental expressions for strain energy, axial force, flexure, shear and torsion. So now we start with application of strain energy in analysis and design. So we have the first example on direct equivalent work. So I told you, load does work. The work done by the load is stored as internal work, which is called strain energy. How about equating these two, trying to get the response quantity? Here you see a cantilever beam of span L and of X modulus E and inertia I. EI is the flexural rigidity. We have a concentrated load P at the end, and if the end deflection is delta, the work done by the load is P delta by 2. So we assume the loads are applied gradually. When the load P is zero, displacement also is zero. And the load attains the full value of P, displacement also attains the full value of P. So the work done is P delta by 2. If we write out the expression for the external work, P delta by 2 on the left side is the work done by the external load. And we write the expression for the internal work. In terms of flexure, we have seen the bending moment at any point x from the load, at any point x from the load is P into x. And we have seen the expression for change energy due to moment, which is m squared by 2EI into L. Here we take a small element of length dx. And for that element of length dx, it becomes Px the whole squared by 2EI dx. And we integrate it for the entire beam from 0 to L with the coordinate axis located at the load. So if you do that, left hand side is still P delta by 2. And on the right hand side, P squared comes out, the load is constant. 2EI is a constant, it comes out. We have a prismatic beam. X squared integral is x cubed by 3. And if you put the limits, we'll get the value as P2 squared L cubed by 6EI. And simplifying, you get the displacement delta as PL cubed by 3EI, which is the very well known result for a cantilever beam loaded with a concentrated load with the free end. This is what we call as direct equivalence. You are equating external work to internal work. But the problem is, this will not work always. Why it will not work always? What are the difficulties? We'll see later. And before we see more on applications of strain energy methods, you should recognize strain energy is one of the traditional classic for all time, very powerful. Definitely there are other alternatives available, and if you ask any analyst or any designer, everyone will agree virtual work is the most versatile and most not only versatile, applicable various situations. It is even more powerful too. Energy methods are, even though alternatives like virtual work are available, and there are subtle differences. Many people have, confusion between all these methods. Say in structural mechanics, you have this energy method, you have the virtual work method, you have the theorems, Castigliano's, then you have Bittis theorem, Maxwell's theorem. When you see them, we get confused as to what is the difference. Is there a difference at all? There are subtle differences in the assumptions made and in the final result obtained. Subtle differences definitely are there. Like for example, in virtual work, we don't get the half term at all. Not real work. Subtle differences are there. And even though virtual work methods, there are other powerful alternatives available to energy methods. Energy methods are traditional and they definitely give an insight to the behavior of the element of the structure. Definitely strain energy methods are very advantageous in some situations. Some situations strain energy methods have an edge over others in indeterminate structure. They definitely are of help in matrix formulation, and they'll also define application in structural dynamics, addressing structural dynamics problems. So we'll just see the prototypes of the Castigliano's theorem, and in the afternoon session, we'll see the application. What you have in the right-hand corner is the load displacement curve. Load has been plotted along the vertical axis, y-axis, displacement along the x-axis. So very plotting itself tells us we have bias for displacement. We are calling displacement an independent variable. Load as the dependent variable, right? And the red curve is the load displacement curve. Okay, displacement is along x-axis, load is along the y-axis. If you take a small vertical segment of the area under the curve for a designated displacement of delta 1, you give a small additional displacement, you can set up a vertical bulb, forms a part of the area beneath the curve. And the area of this small part is P1 into delta D delta 1. P1 into D delta 1 is the height of the small red vertical column, which is T, is a strain energy. A derivative of this with respect to the upper limit, derivative of this expression with respect to the upper limit, you have U, the entire area of the load displacement curve beneath the curve, is given by U is equal to integral of 0 to delta P1 D delta 1. A derivative of this with respect to the upper limit is du by d delta. And this is equal to P is the essence of Castigliano's first theorem. It's the partial derivative of the strain energy with reference to displacement or with respect to displacement gives you the load. Partial derivative of strain energy with respect to displacement gives the conjugate load. This is the first theorem. Similarly, if you see the sketch below, there is a horizontal bar set up, shaded blue, right, which forms the part of the area of the curve above, enclosed by the axis and the curve above. This is called a complementary energy, complementary strain energy. Beneath the curve is called strain energy. The area above is called complementary energy, and the blue strip is the part. So the derivative of this, that is U star, or put the asterisk, that denotes complementary strain energy. And U star is obtained as integral of 0 to P delta 1 into dP1, small difference in the load itself. The derivative of this with respect to the upper limit, the derivative, that is du star by dp, is delta. This is called Castigliano's second theorem. Partial derivative of the complementary strain energy with respect to load should give you the conjugate displacement. These are called the prototypes of the theorem. So the first version, or the primary version of the Castigliano's theorem, or this very simple to understand. I'll tell you again, the strain energy, you see the red vertical strip set up. The area of the red vertical strip is P1 to D delta 1. We are ignoring infinite size and primarily small term. The actual area has a small triangle at top, which is actually dp1 into d delta 1 by 2. Hence, the difference of themselves are small. 0.1 into 0.1 is 0.01. That is being ignored. Area of this small strip integrated over the full range of displacement is integral of 0 to delta p1 d delta 1. That is u, that is strain energy. The derivative of this with respect to upper limit will become du by delta, or du by d delta if you have only one node. That gives the conjugate force. So differentiating with respect to displacement should give you the force. And the next is the complementary energy set up by the blue strip. The partial derivative of that should give you conjugate displacement. partial derivative of complementary strain energy with respect to load should give you the conjugate displacement. These are called the prototypes of Castigliano's theorem. So when you come to an indeterminate structure, if the structure is linear elastic, we have a redundant force, let us say R. And if you are writing the expression for the strain energy and differentiating it with respect to the redundant reaction, you should get the conjugate displacement. And usually redundant reactions will have zero displacement conjugate with them. It means deba U by deba R, which is the partial differentiation of strain energy with respect to the redundant reaction, is should give us conjugate displacement delta, and that is zero. No displacement is being allowed at the redundant reaction location. If that is zero, what this tells us is this can be interpreted as a condition for extreme value of strain energy function. You are representing strain energy either in terms of loads or in terms of displacement. The first derivative, if it is zero, here the strain energy with reference to loads differentiated with respect to one of the redundant reactions, if that is zero, it tells us it is an extreme condition, the condition for extreme value of the strain energy function. Means when we are doing the differentiation, if you are getting the first derivative as zero, it tells us there is an extreme value for that function. And from the second derivative, we can always conclude if the second derivative is positive, the value of the function is the minimum. And here it can be demonstrated in case of strain energy. The second derivative is always positive because strain energy itself has a positive value. The first derivative gives you the, in case of redundant reaction, should give you the conjugate displacement, which is zero. I mean, the first differential is zero, means there is an extreme value. The second differential definitely is positive, so the strain energy is minimum. This is what we call as the theorem of least work, the minimum energy theorem. And all these are of great help for us in employing strain energy method in structural mechanics. This was what I wanted to convey in the first session. We will see example of utility of whatever we see here in the afternoon session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for the wonderful session. So we'd like to have a group photo session, sir. Participants, kindly switch on your video.
Hello. Okay.
Yes, sir. So we'd like to have a group photo session, sir.
Okay, please.
Yeah, yes, sir. Participants, kindly switch on your video. Dear participants,
just to take a screenshot, and Professor, that's enough, right?
Okay, ma'am. Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
So, So hope we can have the question and answer session in the afternoon, sir, at the end of the second session.
Can we leave now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So we rejoin for the afternoon session. That is at 1:30, no?
Yes, sir. 1:30, sir.
1:30. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.